there's a real renaissance in Manchester at the moment for queer clubbing, I think. There's lots going on.
It's places like Body Horror where you really feel an energy that isn't necessarily as easy to tap into in mainstream spaces.
I definitely think with the arrival of the White Hotel, it's made a huge impact on the way we curate our parties.
Downtown Manchester's kind of finished as a place, really. This is the beginning of a movement now, which is going to go to the Twilight areas of Manchester, you know, the Shadowlands, and that's where all the magic's going to happen.
I moved to Manchester in January 1998. I didn't really understand identity and identity politics then. I had no knowledge of queer politics or history or anything really at that point. But for me, it felt like the kind of pillars of my identity were, one, I'm Northern and I'm really proud of that. Two, undeniably I'm queer. And three, and more importantly, and much bigger than either of those two things, I'm a music fan and I need to go where the good music is. Older lesbians around me started telling me stories about the protests that they went on, the marches and the demos. And then they started telling me about Section 28 in 1988, like the last piece of anti-gay legislation in this country. They educated me about James Anderton, the Chief Constable of Manchester, and he was rampantly homophobic. And I started realising what an incredible fight had been fought.
When the Clause 28 march happened, seeing that many gay people on the streets did change things up quite a lot. And the people that organised it, they went around all the gay clubs, they stood on chairs in gay pubs and said, this march is happening, we want you to come.
We are 12% of the people on this earth and 12% of the children will be lesbians and gays. Who the hell's going to get a closet big enough for all of us?
Because we'd worked together in that struggle, that fed into the clubs a lot. So gay men and lesbians were going out together much more and they wanted spaces that they were in to reflect that. Hundreds and thousands of people trying to get into gay clubs, which is what happened with Flesh. You know, we literally had to put on the tickets, thank you for not being heterosexual. Heterosexuals will not be admitted. There was loads of women there that I just never clapped eyes on before, which is weird on such a small scene. You know, you get used to seeing the same faces. We had an ice cream van in the Hacienda and the fire brigade came in to just do a check on us, and then they got really annoyed that we'd got an ice cream van full of petrol in the middle of the dance floor in the Hacienda. It's obviously like, and everyone was smoking in the club and they didn't tell us to get it out of the club. They just said, could we push it towards the fire exits, keep it in a rammed club of 1,500 people, but just put it towards the exit and that would be all right then.
This must have been a piece promoting the first ever Homo Electric here. It states how open they are on the door. Mm. If you're homo, hetero, don't know, or lesbo, you're welcome, which was very different to the Flesh door policy.
It was basically a place for all misfits that loved music and loved partying in a really solid way. And that was more important than who you slept with.
Be ugly was there.
And in fact, there's badges slogan. And everything that just say be ugly. I think they still use that actually as a slogan. Tennis. And that's where the beauty is, isn't it? In choosing to be ugly and not giving a toss.
Homo Electric. Started a long time ago in a venue very similar to Hidden, which was an old lesbian club on the edge of the village. The gay culture in Manchester became very commercial, and it was, I guess, a reaction to that. And years on, here in Hidden, I guess nothing has changed, really, in the sense that it's still on the edge of the city.
Queer as Folk had a massive effect, because I was going to the village a lot at that time, and it was almost overnight. You could just sense that people were just turning up like tourists, just kind of... The secret was out, really.
It's still obviously a completely necessary, amazing space and crucial for the city, but, yeah, I think it did kind of maybe start
it
to change
it,
when it,
it took
became
the sheen off
commercially
it,
known to the nation.
There's a warmness and a friendliness now which I've not seen for such a long time. And it reminds me of when I first arrived in Manchester in the mid-80s up to Acid House, where there was this almost evangelism with music.
It's always been disco, house, techno.
Definitely rooted in black music,
yeah.
I would say.
You know, when Nicky Ciano came up here, it was like, oh my God! Because it's not a shiny club. It's like the way clubbing used to be back in the 70s in Lower East Side and all those places where it was, when you walk around the wrong corner, it was rough. When I first went to my first gay club when I was 16, I loved it. I loved being comfortable. I felt comfortable with gay men and lesbian women because I didn't have to be something I wasn't. So for me, the best stuff has always happened with in gay areas. Some of the best clubs in the world have come out of that. Sexuality isn't the issue, you know. People don't come here to fuck each other. Well, they might do, but it's a byproduct of people actually just wanting to come here and listen to music. The fact it's gay is just where it is. It just happens to be the home we found.
Me and Robbie met in 2014. We just wanted to create a night that was basically accessible for everyone.
The kind of initiator for the night was to book DJ Sprinkles, who we managed to get to play for us in our second event.
From my personal experience, coming to Islington Mill when I was like 16, and just feel like I can be whoever I want to be. We kind of wanted to replicate that and create something of our own, which wasn't necessarily focused at being a gay night, but was just a...
all-inclusive environment.
Yeah, 100%.
We came together through putting on a party which was headed up by somebody else, and obviously we didn't have a lot of input. There was about 1,900 people involved.
Yeah, it was less people than some solid crew.
No one else was doing that pay what you want sort of vibe then.
It was a good tactic for us because obviously it brought people in. But it was quite like apologetic as well, like, oh, pay what you want. Like, we were like afraid to even ask people to pay money.
Yeah.
You know, there's hardly any clubs in the actual city centre where promoters can put on parties that have that freedom to, you know, have late licences and have queer performance without it sort of being a commercial aspect. I think that's one of the reasons we've seen a big shift in terms of the nights actually moving to Salford. You know, so you've got Hidden, you've got White Hotel.
There is so few venues now that we would work with.
I think that's sort of why they've all drifted to Salford, because of Salford Council.
Exactly.
Well.
Much more flexible.
I sort of think that all the promoters in Manchester work together.
There's always going to be competition. Like, that's the name of the game, isn't it?
But it doesn't feel like cutthroat or anything. It feels like people are trying their best to make it work, like, together. One of the recent nights that we had Ancient Methods, I remember at one point we were on the dance floor and we kind of looked around and we thought, like, I think we all kind of felt like we'd finally achieved our perfect dance floor. Like, there wasn't like long-haired, like, punk guy.
Yeah.
He was, like, headbanging and, like, moshing next to, like a group of, like, trans, like, voguers. And
yeah.
It just properly
and
felt
old,
like...
old people as well, yeah. You know, someone who was 50s, about... 60s.
Gays love the gymnasium. And there's nothing a gay likes more than a fit, neoclassical physique. I've had to take my top off, and now I'm just wearing this singlet. And that's what gymnasium culture does to you. Ah, look beautiful, and you'll have a beautiful life.
We used to run a night called Tranarchy, which was kind of a free space for gender expression, for people to kind of find out who they were and to experiment and all that stuff without any judgment or anything like that. And body horror is kind of similar in ethos, only it's not strictly gender that we're exploring now, it's more just the body. I don't know, maybe we have idealized the past, but you just look to like the late 70s and the early 80s and leather clubs, and they were playing like amazing proto-techno and like even just high energy disco. But when you go out in Canal Street, you listen to the music and it's rubbish.
It's a way of just playing with sex and sex club culture and making a kind of gender neutral sex space that's not hideously and toxically masculine and doesn't have that kind of aggression that a lot of sex spaces do.
It's places like body horror where you really feel an energy that isn't necessarily as easy to tap into in mainstream spaces.
Whipping me with my own guts, that was a beautiful moment. When I did the performance where I was pulled guts out of my head.
And she was like rising in the primordial.
What did he say to that bar person? He was like, what the fuck is this? And then the bar staff said, it's art.
Whatever happens in body horror stays in body horror. We want to make something that you have to experience in real life.
Queer utopia.
You can't just share the picture on Facebook and signal that you get it. If you weren't there, you weren't there. You can't cash in on it. We know who was there.
Although we did share one picture once because my bum looked nice.
That's
my bum looked really nice.
I originally created it for the night body horror, and the theme for body horror that night was the meat market. So I chose to use the idea of being like a piece of meat hanging in like a butcher's or an abattoir, and I wanted to use it as a parallel for my experience as a trans woman. A lot of the men who are interested in transgender people, a lot of them have never even met a transgender person. And so you're just kind of viewed as a sexual fetish. And there's also a lot of shame that goes along with finding transgender people attractive. When you have sex with someone who feels ashamed of finding you attractive, they pour that shame into you and you carry it and you hold it and it fucks you up really badly. In one way or another, I think Bollocks really like led the way with a lot of things. A lot of nights that became really well established in Manchester started there. Body horror, which is a kind of tonic to how polished and mainstream a lot of the queer nights got. It's just as dirty and nasty as you could possibly imagine. Like the last party, I wear lots of jewellery and one of my rings flew off on the dance floor. I was like, fuck's sake, where's my ring? So I was on the floor. And I was literally amongst guts. Like, there were guts on the floor.
Yeah, I was in a band. And it was very much, you wear this, and this is how you talk, and this is how you behave. I didn't have the opportunity to play and to find people like me. And then now, after being able to, like, experiment with, like, myself and actually find what's going on, I'm just a queer... alien of the world.
Entity. Manchester's just a lot more punk, I think. People just take themselves very, very seriously in London. I don't think that's a bad thing, because I think a lot of people go there to find, like, to like be successful or be an artist or be a designer or be a musician. So everyone does have a much more kind of competitive streak in them. Whereas in Manchester, people are like fucking so happy for you when you have like those opportunities. And you know, if somebody has an amazing thing happen, everyone's like, yeah, they feel like they have like that collective ownership over that experience.
Fucking face. Ah, fuck off. Go on. Fuck.